up here. Thank you very much. It's really exciting to be here, and I'm so delighted so many of you come out to hear us today and all the things we have to say. As Jody mentioned, I'm an entomologist, I'm an insect specialist. I work with our horticulture industries, arborists, vineyards, orchards, vegetable growers, you name it. I work with them. I work with a lot of ticks on Long Island as well. I'm there to help solve insect and mite and tick related problems for the industry, and it is a pretty big job when you live in an area where you have about 2.5 million people within a 50-mile radius. We also are an area where there's very high level of environmental concern. We have pesticides of concern in our groundwater, and main part of my job is helping to mitigate that and reduce the impacts of pesticides and groundwater there. And I have gotten into this certainly because of the negative impacts that pesticides have had. You're all aware of this, you know, health-related issues, but I'm very concerned about their environmental impacts. We don't want them in the groundwater. We also would really like them to be a lot more selective so they're not impacting the natural enemies, the beneficial species, not just bees, but all of them. So I'm really in favor of finding much more selective solutions that more strategically and surgically deal with insect problems in all these different areas. Of course, I'm advising people who do professional landscape management, and they are working in environments with children and pets and lots of people, so there's a lot of concern for those sort of negative effects too. A lot of you are probably aware of this report, the Gardeners Beware. A couple of years ago, they produced this report after sampling plants at a number of garden centers, looking at, say, Home Depot's, Lowe's, and other ones, and found that 50% of these had, quote, high enough neonicotinoids that were high enough to kill honeybees, bumblebees, and pollinators outright. This is a quote from the report. One of the things they did not do in this study, however, was actually look at what's in the pollen and the nectar, and then what impacts is that actually having. What they did is they provided a summary of results of what some of these materials were and what levels they were at in the flower stems and leaves of the plant. So they did not actually go further to look at the amounts that were in the pollen and the nectar, and then what impacts were they having on what different pollinators and other insects were in the environment around. So this is something that is of great interest to me and to Scott McCart and Emma Mullen and others here. We'd really like to know a lot more about these impacts that are going on. There is a fair bit of research, but there's not a huge amount looking at how ornamentals are fitting into this picture and where there's some impacts that these pesticides are having when used on ornamentals. Here's several studies that are mentioned here. Vera Krishup at University of Minnesota, University of Kentucky, and Michigan State University are all doing or have done some research. This is a quick summary of some of the data, residues and pollen and nectar. So there's some studies, if you want, you can look up these or we can get you those, where these are reported of what's in pollen and nectar from various ornamental plants that have been treated with, in this case, imidacloprid, which is one of the neonicotinoid insecticides that are under discussion. University of Kentucky has this proposed work looking at these three kinds of plants, looking at two kinds of neonicotinoids, imidacloprid and dinotefuran, and looking at different application timings, three different timings, pre-bloom in summer and also in November, to these kinds of plants, hawthorn, clethra, and a type of holly. These are all utilized by bees and by pollinators, so they want to see what the impacts are when these are treated. I don't know if any of you have ever heard of mating disruption. Mating disruption is a non-pesticide strategy used in tree fruit. Even some of the fruit farms right around here are using this as a way of controlling some very important pests in tree fruit. Some of our growers are using as many as 5 to 7 pesticide applications a year until we began to introduce this onto Long Island and into our fruiting industry. So this is a tie with this pheromone in it, and you put these around the orchards and you can basically confuse the males so they can't find the females to mate, and then you control the pest that way without an insecticide. And I know this is ornamentals, but this is, I'm leading into something here. This is the damage from oriental fruit moth and an Asian pear. This is one of the targets of this mating disruption strategy, and it works very, very well for oriental fruit moth. So we brought this into the ornamentals world for a pest called oriental beetle, and this is one of the nurseries, a container nursery on Long Island. They were having a very serious problem with this insect called the oriental beetle. This is very much like Japanese beetle, but the adult doesn't feed. You don't see it on plants, but the grub stage feeds below ground in lawns and in potted plants, and they were having very serious tens and tens of thousands of dollars of losses of plants to this. So there was a company that was bringing on this mating disruption product that you can see up here. If I can get the pointer to work here. This is the little packets with the pheromone in it, and you distribute these around the nursery. And the males then think there's a female at every corner. They can't find the true females. And it works, and it's amazing, but it actually works fairly well. And this just shows you over here, the oriental beetle on the left, the Japanese beetle on the right. And I don't believe you have oriental beetle, at least in any numbers up here yet, but you may get them soon. So this is some of the grubs here on the bottom of the pot, and that's what it does to the roots of the plants. It absolutely destroys them. So one nursery was losing huge amounts to that, and these little crosses just represent sort of how we distribute the pheromone. These are hoop houses, different little individual hoop houses, and you distribute it sort of a checkerboard pattern like that. And so you get this cloud of pheromone that basically over the area. You can't see it or detect it, but the beetles sure know that it's there. And this is a chart just showing the numbers. And this high bar here shows the line shows the numbers of beetles we were trapping. You can see up to 5,000. And this is an area without mating disruption. Where we're using mating disruption, this orange line right at the bottom shows you what happens, that you cannot trap any beetles because they cannot orient to the pheromone in a pheromone trap. So it really is truly amazing. This yellow line over here is right on the edge. It was one of the traps we put right on the edge. So you don't get as good a control on the edge as you do, say, in the center of that block. So that's one of the things that our nurseries are using. So these are just some of the numbers from one of this one particular nursery was losing about 30%, almost $40,000 just in azaleas. And they were having losses in other plants. And they were using imidacloprid as a drench. And that wasn't so great because it wasn't working all that well. It was time-consuming, expensive, about $5,500 just for the azaleas alone to do all that treatment. And using the mating disruption, losses are below 5%, and it's costing them about $2,000. So that's a really nice little success story. One thing that we're testing right now is an alternative for grub control in home lawns. Really, when you think about it, there's really not many choices you have. You can get those spikes o' death you put on your feet and walk around and kill the grubs with that. The other thing you can get is you can get a neonicotinoid insecticide, and that works very, very well to control grubs. You can get Dilox, and that's another material. The milky spore does not work for us. We have oriental beetle that does not work for that particular insect, so we have to find something else. But there is a new BT now just coming on the market. This one is now just registered in New York. The grub gone is registered. The beetle gone will probably come along soon. And these can be used. But what we need is some data to show, do these really work? These are a BT type of material, a natural type of a product. And we'd like to see how well they work. So this just shows you the setup. I took this picture just a few days ago in our greenhouse. This is a study that we're doing right now to see whether we can control these oriental beetle grubs in potted plants or in lawns, and whether these materials work as intended. So that will stay tuned, and we'll let you know how the results of that research turn out. I'm faced almost daily with pest problems, people coming to me, what do we do about this? They're destroying my plants. How do I control this? I'm losing a lot of money. I'm losing my business. Customers are really angry at me. How do we solve this? So here's one pest that's come in and caused a lot of frustration. It's called wax scale. It probably won't survive this far north, but it's coming into Long Island from the south and has created enormous problems in some nurseries for various reasons. So we know that the secret to treating and controlling this particular scale insect is to time the treatments, whatever you're doing for it, when these initial crawler or little stages are present. And that only happens at a certain time of year, and you have to know when that happens. So we had tested some different treatments to see what would work. One of the old products you probably heard about is 7, and this Distance is a newer material. It's a growth regulator. It's kind of a greener type of an insecticide. And TriStar is a neonicotinoid, but it is the one neonicotinoid that is relatively non-toxic to honeybees. So you might be surprised to hear that there's actually one that is relatively, at least applied alone. When you mix it with other things, that can change, but at least TriStar alone is relatively non-toxic to honeybees. We don't know about all the other types of pollinators, but at least this one we do know about. So we're just showing you that the numbers of scales per plant here and untreated over here and these treatments are all working very well. So you have at least two alternative options to the older product, and if you preferred not to use the neonicotinoid, you could use the Distance instead. So this just shows you the kind of data, the information that we generate so that people learn about their options, things that they can do as alternatives. And we have followed up this study to look at things like MP, or there's an insecticidal soap and a horticulture oil, to see how well those might work if you prefer to use those particular products. We have greenhouse growers that have tremendous problems with whiteflies. In this case, in poinsettias, you can see a very heavy infestation here. And I want to give a shout out to the IPM program. They deserve an enormous amount of credit for fostering and promoting the use of biocontrols in greenhouses. Betsy Lamb and Brian Eschenauer here in particular have been down to Long Island and done several trainings. They're very, very, really, really good, very knowledgeable, and have helped our growers out a lot with that. So this is a little mini wasp. You can't even see it. It's so small, but it loves to attack whiteflies. And this one's been parasitized. This is normal. And here it is in action right there. And we've got growers that are continuing to use that. The thing with biocontrol, though, is that it's not as simple and easy as you can just release things and pray and hope and wish and fervently, how that they'll do their job. You have to actually make sure that when you buy them that they're alive. And there's a lot of other complications. You have to have the right environment, the right conditions. So this is just a little thing that I developed on how to test for the quality of these little wasps that you buy to make sure you're getting the number in this little packet. It's supposed to be 50. And when they emerge, they'll get trapped on this little yellow card, so you can verify that, yes, we did get 50 on that little card that we were supposed to get. And that's a strategy that we help growers learn. One of the things you have to do if you're going away from pesticides, there's sometimes these other things that you have to accommodate with. This doesn't really apply to bees so much. Orchids are not very much bee pollinated, at least not this kind anyway, here anyway, these Phalaenopsis. But just to give you an idea of the kind of things, other things we're doing. That particular orchid grower was having a terrible problem with mealybugs. Here's what they look like on the bottom of those Phalaenopsis leaves. They were using boatloads of a product called Safari, it's a neonicotinoid, and not getting very good control. And when you see the way the plants grow, you can kind of understand why. When you apply this systemic onto the pots, you've got all these roots and very granular media, so it just flows right through. It doesn't really get taken up very well in the plant. So they weren't getting very good control, and that's at least part of the reason why. So they were coming to me looking for an alternative, and we found out that part of the problem is that these mealybugs were hanging around on these benches and these inanimate surfaces and the old pots that they were reusing. So we got them to stop reusing the old pots, or at least put them out in the winter time in February when it was really cold, and that would kill the mealybugs. Another thing we talked about is getting those benches cleaned up. So what they've done is they actually, and I wasn't aware, but they made a decision. They spent $12,000 to buy this bench washer. And so I have to be really careful what I say to people sometimes. But they bought this bench washer. They actually brought people from Holland to set it up. And you can see this is feeding the bench in there. And there's some nozzles here. So this was sort of scrubbing the bench off. And we advised them just to use water alone. And since they've been doing this and not reusing those old pots, they have stopped having mealybug problems on the Phalaenopsis. So it's a really, really win-win situation. And they've really paid for this machine several times over at this point. I've become very interested in sort of the alternative materials because particularly the urban audience that we work with, the people in landscapes, they're very interested in options. And so you'll see a lot of these sort of products that sound interesting with cinnamon oil. I mean, you could even just use them as air fresheners, if not insecticides, I guess. But they actually do smell really good. We used this in the greenhouse. It smelled like an apple pie somebody just baked. It was pretty fantastic. This one, though, it smells like fish, so you really want to be careful with that. But so we had done some. We've done a lot of testing with some of these because we're curious to see, do they really work? A lot of these companies don't do a lot of advanced testing. So this is just one of the charts showing you how well this works. So these plants were just sprayed with water for two spotted mites and roses. And we used some of these alternative products, and the numbers stayed fairly low. They didn't go quite to zero, but they're staying much, much lower. So you can see compared to spraying things with water, it looks pretty good. But one of the cautions I want to make is that some of these products are not very well tested. They're not very well screened. So we found out that this particular material, This one material we use called Indoor Farm had burned off the flowers from this plant. You can see this kind of stunted. So it did control the aphids, though. That was the good news. So they definitely control the aphids. And some of the other materials we have here, you can see that this particular one, this Botanigard, which is widely used in greenhouses, the liquid formulation, this is a biological material. It's a natural fungus. This particular material can actually damage the leaves very, very seriously in poinsettia. You can see these brown spots and the yellowing, and pretty soon all these leaves fell off. But there is a powder formulation of this, so you can use the powder form instead of the liquid form and not have this problem and still get some whitefly control out of this particular biological material. This is a product that was used for tick control. It's an organic material, and it doesn't really control ticks very well, but you can see what it does to the foliage of ornamental plants. It burns it pretty badly right here. So that was another thing that, so I hope to make those kind of mistakes so people who need to learn what to do about them don't make them instead and find out a real big problem afterwards. Here's some organicide injury to mini rows, and so just to some of the cautions to be aware of, when you get into this alternative world, you sometimes run into things that you need to, more information you need to know, things that maybe you weren't expected to happen when you use them. So I hope I can help people not have those problems, and I can make all those mistakes all on my own. So I guess we'll have questions later on. We want to move on to the next speaker. Sure.